"It would be far better not to respect me at all," said the queen, with a chilling irony of manner; "it would be far better if you were not innocent. Do you presume to suppose that I should be satisfied simply to leave you unpunished, if you had committed the fault?" "Oh, madame, you are killing me!" "No acting, if you please, or I will precipitate the denouement of this play. Leave the room. Return to your own apartment, and I trust my lesson may be of service to you." "Madame," said La Valliere to the Duchess of D'Orleans, whose hand she seized in her own, "do you, who are so good, intercede for me?" "I," replied the latter, with an insulting joy, "I, good? Ah, mademoiselle, you think nothing of the kind." And with a rude, hasty gesture, she repulsed the young girl's grasp. La Valliere, instead of giving away, as from her extreme pallor and her tears the two princesses possibly expected, suddenly resumed her calm and dignified air. She bowed profoundly and left the room. "Well," said Anne of Austria to Madame, "do you think she will begin again?" "I always suspect those gentle, patient characters," replied Madame. "Nothing is more full of courage than a patient heart, nothing more self-reliant than a gentle spirit. I feel, I may almost venture to assure you, she will think twice before she looks at the god Mars again. So long as she does not obtain the protection of his buckler, I do not care," retorted Madame. A proud, defiant look of the queen mother was the reply to this objection, which was by no means deficient in finesse, and both of them, almost sure of their victory, went to look for Maria Theresa, who had been waiting for them with impatience. It was about 6:30 in the evening, and the king had just partaken of refreshment. He lost no time, but the repast finished and the business matters settled, he took Saint Aignan by the arm and desired him to lead the way to La Valliere's apartments. The courtier uttered an exclamation. "Well, what is that for?" "It is a habit you will have to adopt, and in order to adopt a habit, one must make a beginning." "Oh, sire," said Saint Aignan, "it is hardly possible, for everyone can be seen entering or leaving those apartments. If, however, some pretext or other were made use of, if your majesty, for instance, would wait until Madame were in her own apartments—" "No pretext, no delays. I have had enough of these impediments and mysteries. I cannot perceive in what respect the king of France dishonors himself by conversing with an amiable and clever girl. Evil be to him who evil thinks. Will your majesty forgive an excess of zeal on my part? Speak freely." "How about the queen?" "True, true. I always wish the most entire respect to be shown to her majesty. Well, then, this evening only will I pay Mademoiselle de la Valliere a visit, and after today I will make use of any pretext you like. Tomorrow we will devise all sorts of means. Tonight I have no time." Saint Aignan made no reply. He descended the steps preceding the king, and crossed the different courtyards with a feeling of shame, which the distinguished honor of accompanying the king did not remove. The reason was that Saint Aignan wished to stand well with Madame, as well as with the queens, and also that he did not, on the other hand, want to displease Mademoiselle de la Valliere, and in order to carry out so many promising affairs, it was difficult to avoid jostling against some obstacle or other. Besides, the windows of the young queen's rooms, those of the queen mother's, and of Madame herself, looked out upon the courtyard of the maids of honor. To be seen, therefore, accompanying the king, would be effectually to quarrel with three great and influential princesses, whose authority was unbounded, for the purpose of supporting the ephemeral credit of a mistress. The unhappy Saint Aignan, who had not displayed a very great amount of courage in taking La Valliere's part in the park of Fontainebleau, did not feel any braver in the broad daylight, and found a thousand defects in the poor girl, which he was most eager to communicate to the king. But his trial soon finished. The courtyards were crossed, not a curtain was drawn aside, nor a window opened. The king walked hastily, because of his impatience, and the long legs of Saint Aignan, who preceded him. At the door, however, Saint Aignan wished to retire, but the king desired him to remain. A delicate consideration on the king's part, which the courtier could very well have dispensed with. He had to follow Louis into La Valliere's apartment. As soon as the king arrived, the young girl dried her tears, but so precipitately that the king perceived it. He questioned her most anxiously and tenderly, and pressed her to tell him the cause of her emotion. "Nothing is the matter, sire," she said. "And yet you were weeping." "Oh, no, indeed, sire. Look, Saint Aignan, and tell me if I am mistaken." Saint Aignan ought to have answered, but he was too much embarrassed.